chief guest, Professor Kamaldeen, sir. Guests of honor, Professor Asita De Silva and Dr. Panduka Karunanayake. Immediate past president, my friend, Dr. Mahanama Gunasekara. Director General of Health Services, Dr. Anil Jayasinghe. Thank you for coming, sir. Past presidents of the college, members of the council, officials of the sister colleges, distinguished guests, colleagues, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen. It's my utmost honor and privilege to address you at this ceremony of my induction as the 37th president of the College of Surgeons of Sri Lanka. At this moment, my memory runs to the era of the dawn of the millennium, where I, along with a few friends, took life membership of this organization, which was a single room affair at that monumental house of distinguished physician, late Dr. Vijayarama, which gave shelter to many abiding academic organizations at the time. Then onwards, first as an ordinary member, and then later 6 years as a member of the council and president-elect, I have witnessed the College of Surgeons blossoming into what it's today under the patronage and untiring and selfless efforts of many surgical giants this country produced, and moving into this magnificent premise, which is an invaluable gift to the surgical fraternity of this country by the legendary surgeon Dr. Noel Bartholomew and his beloved wife Nora. I would pledge to give my best to continue the ethics and traditions of the college and strive to uphold the good name and the position of this organization, which has been safeguarded hitherto by my predecessors during my tenure with all my strength. College of Surgeons has become a respected and a prominent organization with national and international acceptance. It's working closely with the Ministry of Health, Postgraduate Institute of Medicine, statutory organizations such as National Medicines Regulatory Authority, National Science Foundation, Sri Lanka Armed Forces, Kothalawala Defense Academy, and many other governmental and non-governmental organizations, which has put us in a position where a substantial impact on the surgical care of Sri Lanka can be made. It is headquarters of the SARC Surgical Care Society and is closely linked to the Royal Colleges of Surgeons of Edinburgh and England, and Australasian, Malaysian, and Thai Colleges of Surgeons. It is also in the process of developing close ties with renowned surgical societies as International Surgical Society. The Royal College of Surgeons of Glasgow recently not only honored Dr. Mahanama Gunasekara, our immediate past president, and Professor Srinath Chandrasekara, the vice president of my council, with honorary fellowships, but also offered automatic membership to all candidates who pass the MD surgery exam, an honor they have not bestowed on any organization outside UK hitherto. They were also instrumental in obtaining the recognition of the General Medical Council of the UK for the candidates who are successful at the surgery MD. In spite of frequent ambiguities we face and many uncertainties hanging in the air, I still consider myself lucky to be born in this beautiful country and to live among many who love and cherish me and look up to me. The freedom of work, diversity of cases, friendly staff, and grateful patients have made my work enjoyable as a general surgeon for the past 2 decades. I believe qualified, dedicated, skilled, experienced, and knowledgeable staff, and the high literacy rate among the patients are responsible for the good health in disease Sri Lanka is enjoying despite comparatively low budgetary allocations. At this point, I would like to introduce our theme for 2019, which is access to acceptable care for all and beyond. The WHO introduced the concept of universal health coverage, commonly known as UHC, in 2010, which is defined as access to health services without a financial burden. Access to health encompasses physical accessibility, financial affordability, and socio-cultural acceptability, which are essential in the delivery of equitable health care. Sri Lanka, being a country with free health and good health indices, accessibility to acceptable care is not far-fetched from us in comparison with other low and middle-low income countries in the region. However, with little effort and ingenuity, we can and must aim to reach beyond towards excellence of care. The physical accessibility not only denotes the access to a surgeon, but also the availability of the necessary equipment, human resources, and infrastructure needed for him to function effectively. There are 12 teaching hospitals, 3 provincial hospitals, 19 district general hospitals, and 27 grade A district-based hospitals spread within the length and the breadth of this country, with units of specialist surgical cover to serve a population of 21.44 million, nearly 21 and a half, while Singapore serves its 2.62 million, nearly a quarter of our population, with only 5 well-equipped hospitals. Appointing well-trained surgeons to stations with no facilities would blunt their skills, make them frustrated, and lead them to leave the system. Sri Lanka, being relatively a small country with fairly motorable roads, a good ambulance system, and low-cost public transportation, we should concentrate on expanding the existing surgical units and fortifying them with necessary infrastructure to serve the population effectively, rather than haphazardly opening ill-equipped units without a master plan. It is also possible to have more efficient and cost-effective use of human resources and equipment by developing well-designed hospital clusters in the same geographical vicinity to share them. I am happy the Minister of Health is seeking the advice, college advice, in making their decisions, such as surgeons' cadre, required minimum basic facilities, and quality assurance of surgical equipment and medicines. College opinions have maximum transparency and are given by panels of experienced and learned members with no vested interests. Access to affordable health care is defined as for all people, including the poorest and the most vulnerable, to get full range of essential health services, including prevention, treatment, hospital care, and pain control, by shared costs among the entire population through prepayment and risk pooling, rather than shouldered by the sick. Access should be based on the need and should be unrelated to ability to pay. Various countries of the world have adopted various methods to meet the health funding, namely taxation money from the government, social health insurance, voluntary or private health insurance, out-of-pocket expenditure, donations, and charities. Countries like the UK depends mainly on taxation, while Germany, Singapore, and Japan depend on social health insurance, with the government acting as the primary payer. The USA has a system with mainly private health insurance. Sri Lanka has got a mixture of all. Entirely free public health care with a cost share of 56% and the rest consisting of private health expenditure, mainly out-of-pocket payments. Our health expenditure is bound to increase in the future due to several reasons. Firstly, rising income levels associated with transition to middle income status, with greater expectation of more expensive treatment and higher service quality. Secondly, meeting health needs of the increasing aging population. And thirdly, the increase in non-communicable diseases related to an epidemiological transition. I think providing an entirely free tax-based state-run health service is too much to bear for a low middle-income country such as ours. As much as we make health affordable and easily accessible, we need to cultivate an attitude among the patients to value the service they are rendered. I have witnessed some patients throwing the medicines away, given to them free of charge from government hospitals, while some insist on admission without an indication and try to prolong their stay with no justifiable reason. We could always give a better quality care if we move to affordable, but a cost-sharing system involving health insurance, which should make the patient appreciate the value of the service he or she gets. Although I fully understand the socio-political complexities, difficulties and rebound effects of such policy change, it would be very difficult for a middle-low-income country such as ours to achieve excellent and sustainable health care of modern standards without a degree of cost-sharing. While on the topic of affordability, one can't forget the part of the National Medicines Regulatory Authority, which has done a commendable job to significantly reduce the prices of some commonly prescribed medicines, cardiac stents and cataract lenses. I was indeed privileged to witness my colleagues in the board of the NMRA, headed by the chairman, my friend, Professor Asita De Silva, carrying out an uphill task of regulation of one of the most difficult commodities of the world with much transparency and fairness. The socio-cultural environment varies not only from country to country, but also regionally in the same country. The allopathic system of medicine, English language, attitudes and behavior of a Western doctor alienate us from the rural community. As a surgeon who has worked in rural areas for most of my career, I have realized the value of merging and working with the local community, religious and political leaders of the area, which not only would make your working environment pleasant, but also would muster the support and acceptance in the activities and programs of patient care. Methods of breaking bad news, handling bereavement, and other social interactions should be localized for acceptance and should not be directly imported from the West. We have close-knit families with generally strong family ties, which can be used in seamless care, the safe transition from hospital to home. However, there are instances that the patient needs more rehabilitation before being released to the home environment, especially in situations such as spinal injury. The halfway home built in Avisavela by the Sri Lanka Spinal Cord Network, led by energetic Dr. Narendra Pinto, one of our much loved past presidents and very proactive member of the College of Surgeons, is one such example. The project was started about 6 years ago when I was attached to the base hospital Avisavela as a general surgeon. And I was fortunate to represent College of Surgeons as the president-elect at the opening ceremony last year. This project was fully supported by the religious, social, and political segments of the area alike, and is a good example for socio-cultural acceptance. I was happy to see that the WHO Office for Southeast Asia has commended Sri Lanka on monitoring of the universal health coverage and sustainable development goals in their news bulletin. I'm delighted to have Dr. Pali Tabekon with us tonight, who is a veteran of WHO. With the increasing longevity and advancing science and technology, we would be facing a different set of surgical problems, mainly related to non-communicable diseases cardiovascular, neurological, renal, malignant, degenerative, endocrine, including diabetes mellitus. These facts would have to be considered in designing the policies of surgical training, infrastructure, and human resource development. The policy should be patient-centric, placing the common interest above the individual. Need for mature, unselfish, far-sighted, and progressive approach to all stakeholders, such as trade unions, academic bodies, bureaucrats, and politicians, cannot be overemphasized for us to move towards excellence in healthcare. Out of all diseases, diabetes mellitus has shown to cause the second highest loss of disability-adjusted life years, with the most significant increase of 35% during the past 10 years. Surgeons are involved in the management of many facets of this multi-system disease, including diabetic foot. We are happy to contribute in a significant manner to the programs organized by the Sri Lanka Diabetes and Cardiovascular Initiative with the patronage of the Ministry of Health, Sri Lanka College of Endocrinologists, Sri Lanka Medical Association, and DFOOT International Organization. Another area needs to be addressed urgently in Sri Lanka is trauma, especially which involves road traffic accidents. This is the 10th cause of the loss of disability-adjusted life years in the country, causing severe socio-economic impact on the country. I am displaying this slide not to undermine the importance of the dengue control program. In fact, it just displays the efficiency and the commitment of the stakeholders, especially when the number of suspected cases were in the excess of 174,000. Such low rates of mortality show the excellent patient management and the organizational integrity of the program. My intention was to stress the importance of a similar drive with active participation of statutory, law enforcement, non-governmental and community-based segments of Sri Lanka. The College of Surgeons, along with its entire membership, would be willing to render its fullest support in primary and secondary prevention of trauma. National Trauma Management Course, NTMC, spearheaded by Dr. Ranjit Tellavala, has done a yeoman service by training the medical officers both in the periphery as well as in the centers. A course for nursing officers also has been floated with overwhelming acceptance and interest. Dr. Kirti Abhayjeeva and several other college members have been able to bring popular advanced trauma life support, in short ATLS course, to Sri Lanka in a sustainable manner. The world-renowned ATLS would not only bring international recognition to college, but also would be a mode of revenue once established, apart from the benefit gained by the trainees in acute trauma care. Although the concept of clinical governance started in the UK following Bristol Heart Scandal in 1995, it had become a common and essential component of modern patient care all over the world. Education and training, clinical audit, clinical effectiveness, research and management, openness, risk management, and information management are the main components of clinical governance. The aim of this would be to shift the responsibility of policy development, improvement, and maintenance of acceptable patient care from one individual healthcare professional to a group consisting of health professionals, health administrators, patients, social groups, and other stakeholders. Health Ministry has promoted and promised to enforce the use of WHO-recommended operating theatre checklist in all government hospitals, which is welcomed by the Colleges of Surgeons and Anesthesiologists of Sri Lanka. Good patient management protocols such as early warning scores and multidisciplinary team approach should be encouraged when and wherever possible for good governance. The modern world has moved away from the big surgeons make big incisions era. We should encourage to popularize the modern surgical techniques such as minimal access surgery, both laparoscopic and robotic. if we are to maintain our place and recognition among the international surgical community. I am thankful to the past president, Dr. K.L. Fernando, who not only pioneered the laparoscopic cholecystectomy in Sri Lanka when I was a final year medical student, but also was instrumental in building of the skills lab for the college, which has been the feeding grounds of many young surgical laparoscopists of Sri Lanka. We need to congratulate Dr. Bhavanta Gamage, who recently delivered the oration of the Association of Minimal Access Surgeons of India. Laparoscopy is the panacea of all abdominal surgery at the SAARC Surgical Congress held recently in Chennai, India. Bhavanta, with many others, have been involved in teaching laparoscopy to the surgical trainees at the regularly held basic laparoscopic workshops by the college. We are taught the famous adage regarding the surgical training, see one, assist one, and do one. However, this does not match well with today's concept of patient safety and good clinical governance. Simulation-based training, which is used in a big way in the aviation industry and the military, has been introduced to modern surgical training. This will allow us to gain new skills and to consolidate it and improve the existing ones with no risk to the patient. The college, with the collaboration of the College of Anesthesiologists and several other stakeholders, is in the planning stage of building a state-of-the-art simulation center, which would not only help our trainees and patients, but also be a source of income to the college. Risk management, the identification and intervention of risks to the patient, the professionals and the organizations with proper incident reporting is another area we cannot boast about. Healthy incident reporting should be facilitated to identify the adverse events to determine the policies needed to better healthcare. An efficient method of bed management is needed to avoid bed patient mismatch, which is not uncommon in our public sector hospitals. I think it's unfair for patients to sleep on the floor in some units while some have vacant beds in the same hospital. An efficient method of management would not only improve patient comfort but also reduce the overcrowding and increase the efficiency of the service with better outcome. However, this would require the involvement, input, and the support of all involved parties and needs a major shift of the mindset, and if achieved, would be an important step forward in the clinical governance of this country. Data management has progressed in leaps and bounds in this world, starting off with large and immobile mainframe computers, progressing to desktops, laptops, tabs, and to smartphones and smartwatches during our lifetime. The information technology, artificial intelligence, and automation are being used in many aspects of healthcare, such as data storage, retrieval, and transfer to good effect, and many other aspects, such as research, innovations, and bed management and distribution of medicines all over the world, which we too should follow to achieve excellence in cost-effective, sustainable, and affordable patient care. The studies done and the attempts made so far have shown that the conversion of manual to electronic record management needs long duration of training and has displayed physician acceptance. However, once established, it has been shown to be acceptable and beneficial. Ethical practice is essential to achieve excellence in healthcare. It generally involves demonstrating respect for key moral principles that include autonomy, justice, beneficence, and non-maleficence, which give empowerment to the patient. More close to our own culture, Satara Sangraha Vastu, or four elements of good service, Dana, Piyavachana, Artacharya, and Samanatmata, or English, generosity, politeness, beneficence, and equity describe the basic principles of medical ethics. Surgical registrars, being the toddlers of surgery, constantly and closely observe their trainers, considering them as role models. Therefore, it is our duty not only to engage in good ethical practice, but also to talk about it, often showing the way. We also need to be aware of the special areas of modern ethical dilemmas we would be exposed as the surgeons. Association with human organ and tissue transplantation. Associated with human organ and tissue transplantation, good governance in medicines, increasing aging population and research. We were taught in school that rules become traditions and traditions become ethics and were made to follow them to the letter. It's duty of the regulating bodies to maintain stringent control of good ethical practice in patient care in an independent, fair and transparent manner. Better training given by dedicated and knowledgeable trainers, the advanced up-to-date knowledge, technology and skills which are more easily acquired by the internet access and other modern amenities, present-day trainees have a better chance of attaining a higher level of skills and knowledge easily. However, the clinical decisions based on experience tend to be more practical and accurate in seniors with better judgment. We should promote intermingling of these qualities of better patient care. The senior surgeons should be encouraged to acquire new skills and knowledge, while the young surgeons should be given every opportunity to improve their skills, knowledge and experience with good interrelationships. We should encourage active participation of younger generation of surgeons in college activities and seriously consider their views in policy making and future projects. Ladies and gentlemen, the science and the art of surgery is expanding rapidly with fast emerging new knowledge, technology and skills, which makes it extremely difficult for one individual to keep track of it all. On the other hand, the patients are more up to date and they have easy access to facts through internet and other sources and becoming more demanding. These facts would make old fashioned head to toe surgeon not only unrealistic, but also dangerous. Increased inter-specialty cooperation and special interest training is most important to overcome this problem. We are extremely fortunate to have all the surgical specialties under one umbrella here at the College of Surgeons. And I strongly believe that the strength of the college lies with the unity and the mutual cooperation of these sister surgical associations, and would do my best to cultivate it further during my tenure. I hope the bird consists of associations will carry the college high in the coming year. With that happy note of unity, cooperation and hope, I would conclude my speech tonight. Although Dr. Amila Jayasekara, Secretary of College, would deliver a formal vote of thanks, I would like to thank few people of my own, without whom I think I would never have been able to face this challenge. Let me first of all thank our outgoing president, my good friend and colleague, Dr. Mahanama Gunasekara, without whom my task today would have been impossible. Mahanama got me involved in, people who know Mahanama know how he gets people involved. Got me involved in many college activities from the outset and always welcomed my opinions. The discussions we had in and out of college have given me an in-depth knowledge and good understanding of college and its functions. Next, I would like to express my gratitude to the Chief Guest, Professor Kemal Dee, for coming here, accepting my invitation, sir. Despite his extremely busy schedule and all the help and support given to make this occasion a success. Thank you, sir. Dear Asita and Panduga, thank you for the marvelous contribution at the Guest of Honor. I'm really proud of you being my childhood friends, climbing so to such heights to render an excellent service to this country in your respective fields. Professor M.D. Lamavan, sir. Dear sir, I use this occasion to express my gratitude for the support you extended me throughout useful advice given and experience shared unreservedly. My colleagues in the AGSSL and CSSSL, many thanks to the support extended and the faith you had in me. I would do my best to fulfill your expectations. I also thank all my teachers who taught me how to learn of books and men, but not to depart. At my beloved alma mater, I am extremely happy Mr. K. H. Amaradas, who taught me at the Royal Junior School, is here with his, unfortunately she is not here, the beloved wife. She was a very warm lady. I warmly welcome Mrs. Manal Munasinghe and her husband, our favorite chemistry teacher, who not only taught me, but also taught both my children, getting them excellent grades. Thank you very much, sir and madam. I would thank all my revered teachers from NCMC, and I'm extremely happy that Professor Wilfred Perera, Professor Sujata Salgado, and Professor Rohan Jayasekhar are here tonight to add the value and color to this function. If not for my trainers in surgery, I would never be here. And to them, I am forever indebted. They not only gave me skills and knowledge, but also provided a good example of ethics and attitudes. Likes of Dr. Daya Rodrigo, Dr. P.G. Veerasingham, late Dr. Ganesh Ratnam, and late Dr. Veerasingham of Kandy, to many and so many other excellent teachers who paved the way for me to become what I am today. I am also grateful to Messrs. Hugh Sturzaker, Jerome Pereira, and Julian Sansom, my trainers in the UK, who showed me the value of developing special interest as a general surgeon, which has helped me immensely to date. I thank my trainees, SHOs, HOs, and ward staff for their invaluable support throughout my career. One such example is Dr. Pradeep Ranganan, a superstar who will thrill you with his musical talents at the end of this function. Dear schoolmates of RC class of 80, I'm extremely grateful and happy that my old school buddies are here to share our joy. I hope you would get a chance to have a good time of old comradeship at the reception following this event. My two brothers, sisters-in-law, nieces and nephews, Litmal, our brilliant presenter tonight, Jayavi, Ranudi, and Ashwin for their kindness and love, my in-laws and little ones who have been a real strength for me throughout, especially little Vinuji, who constantly brings brightness and happiness to our home with her frequent visits. I am ever grateful to my aunties and uncles who showered me with love from the day I was born. I am extremely happy that they are here to witness this significant event of my life. My father, Mr. Nissanka Jayawardhana Sr., BA, MA, who is a scholar in Pali and Buddhist culture, was a role model father, whose entire world was his family. I can never repay the debt I owe to him for love, affection, and care I got throughout my entire life. My mother, who was a popular French teacher, I learned the ABCs of how to treat my students and trainees from her. Although she was not the pampering type, the sacrifices she had made for me and my two brothers are unfathomable, and I would be ever grateful to her. Son Mayuka and daughter Savidya have always been the pride of my life. I'm thankful to them for working hard with responsibility to enter the universities of their own choice, engineering faculty of Moratuwa and dental faculty Peradeniya. Their opinions have been greatly helpful to me in making speeches and presentations. If there is someone who has gently and silently sacrificed all she had for me without even a protesting word, that's my wife, the Anusha. I definitely owe you a big thankful. Thank you for relieving me of most of my daily responsibilities, enabling me to divert almost all my energy to academic and clinical work. You are definitely the last, but not the least. Thank you.